Welcome back, everybody. Obviously, networking, building good working relationships with each other is very much part of why we've flown people in from all across Europe to spend time here in Prague. However, we do have some specific input and activities for you. So this next session is quite a substantial session. I know it's exactly what you feel like doing at 4 p.m. on a Saturday, so I hope you've had some coffee and are well hydrated, because this next section is designed to supply you with some clearer understanding of how we can be effective in designing and implementing assessment. And as has already been identified, it's not just the assessments and the exams which uses this format of helping learners to test their understanding. The interactive clinical cases and also IDD approaches where they're used also use the format of question and answers. And that's because that's what teachers do. Asking questions and evaluating the answers is our main tool for checking whether our students are understanding and are actually learning. And so this next session should help you address each of those different parts of the material that we use to deliver in EULAR. I'm just going to mention, first of all, I just should formally introduce myself. My name's Catherine Haynes. I'm the Assistant Professor of Medical Education at the University of Nottingham at the moment. And my day job is concerned with delivering a Master's in Medical Education to clinicians from across the region. And we do that in a form which is 50% blended learning. So 50% of the information and the way we work is in an online environment, and 50% is face-to-face. And so I have to clarify that in the terminology, I am a non-clinician. So I'm a non-something. I'm a non-clinician. But I am actually used to working with clinicians, and for the last 20 years have been working with academics across higher education universities in the UK, across experts in all disciplines, including medicine, to help them to design and deliver and assess learning in a fair, equitable, and publicly accountable way. So I'm very delighted to be able to work with EULAR to help to make sure that we are also delivering assessment and learning in the way that makes that is best practice. So to demonstrate how we are thinking in similar ways, this is my quick list of things that I'm hoping we can improve on. I'm hoping to convince you that if we invest sufficient time and energy wisely in the assessment process, it will become more effective for everyone. And that, in many ways, a lot of that energy and effort is not cognitive or demandingly clever. It's about being sensible and calm and being able to apply processes and procedures. So it's proofreading, checking that we're being clear, making sure that the marks, that the correct answers add up to the correct totals. These sort of things that are demanding of us when we are working with others in teams in ways we were just describing before the break time. And as Jose was just saying, we don't just get people to remember and regurgitate their scientific facts. We use genuine clinical contexts, because those are the genuine contexts in which our learners will be demonstrating their knowledge. We try and use a full range of the types of questions. We make sure we are covering the whole syllabus, that we are sampling, not just from areas which we quite like or where it seems quite easy to ask questions. but sampling from across the whole syllabus that is being delivered. And of course, in order to make sure that we are discouraging guessing and making sure that we are testing people appropriately, we want to avoid just giving people a 50-50 chance of getting it right or wrong. And so a lot of the constructions of the ways we ask questions are to make sure that we are not encouraging people to just guess. We are genuinely testing people's understanding in the clinical context. So let's see how that translates into practice in this session. What I have planned for you is to introduce, refresh our understanding of some of these concepts in assessment, some of the things we do know, to review the range of types of assessment questions that are available to us, to specifically clarify what the do's and don'ts and guidance is for using single best answer questions, which is the most usual widespread method of multiple choice questions used today, and exploring how we can use extended matching questions to vary how we are assessing knowledge, to invite you to have a go at constructing an extended matching question in an area that you are responsible for or concerned with working. And then what I have done is I have designed a checklist which is very similar to the do's and don'ts and the author's guidance, but I have tried to turn it into something which in one place deals with, at the top of it, all of the conceptual issues that we are discussing about assessment to guide you, together with some genuine tick box things to help you to compare with your assessments and to hopefully identify where you can improve them. And so what I've done is I have created a genuine little bank of genuine EULAR questions, and I think there are ways they can be improved by applying the checklist. And so I'm going to invite you to use the checklist that's in your pack and to look at those questions and suggest improvements. But what I don't want you to do is to carefully read the answers, which has also been put in your pack. So I am appealing to your professionalism and your sheer willingness to learn, to have a go yourselves first, and then hopefully we will then be able to come back together and I will go through why I made suggestions about how those questions can be enhanced. Because what I'm wanting to do is to equip you to be able to then go and work in your course teams to use this understanding and this checklist to apply them to your real questions that are in your specific area for which you have responsibility, so that you can genuinely improve the question bank, the questions you have according to these guidelines, and identify areas where you need more questions. And then I have another session teaching with you tomorrow about how to generate further questions. So quite a demanding programme. Got to work together after that before we get to the reward of dinner. So let's keep moving. We've been talking for a bit, so I want you to talk for a bit. I want you to talk to a colleague nearby. I want you to compare and contrast your experience with creating assessments. Now, you've all been assessed for hundreds of hours, I imagine, to get where you are today. As an assessee, as a learner, you've had to pass exams and demonstrate your skills in many, many settings. But many of you will also have been involved in, for example, giving feedback to trainees. That's what we do from the very beginning of your qualified training. You may have assessed people's clinical skills, and you may have set exam questions in your institutions or taken a more formal role with assessment. Or maybe this is the first time you've actually been required to provide genuine exam questions for people. I want you to just compare with a person or persons nearby. So a couple of minutes for that, please. Assessment is quite a hot topic, isn't it? And when people are being assessed, it is also very emotional for them as well. And so that is why we need to invest time to make sure that we are being as clear and fair as we can be to help candidates to be able to get the most out of that part of the process. In a way, you can avoid everything in education except the test. So you can withstand terrible teachers and things that don't suit you at all, but if you want the qualification, if you must pass the test. And so they cannot avoid this. And so it is our role, I think, to try and make sure it's as good as we can make it. So just to remind you about philosophical questions, if you like, what is our assessment at EULAR in terms of assessing people? Well, yes, we are checking that people can recall the relevant facts that may be entirely necessary for practicing that area of medicine. But it may be that that's a relatively minor part of what we're actually wanting to assess at this level of postgraduate education. Although I must say, it does seem to me that people do forget everything they previously learned once they've had an exam on it. So, for example, anaesthetists, I know, make sure that at the start of the actual clinical training for to become an anaesthetist, they have a short, sharp shock and they test people on their understanding of blood gas ratios and everything that underlies practice as an anaesthetist, just to make sure people are activating their prior learning and being able to bring their knowledge into that clinical context. But primarily, we're wanting them to integrate their understanding into that clinical context so that they can choose between different possibilities of treatment and they can operate at these higher cognitive levels. Because just parroting a fact is not the same as understanding, and it's not the same as applying it effectively in current clinical practice, and we'll return to that idea. We want to see people demonstrate that they can apply this knowledge. We want them to show that they can clinically problem solve and that they're at the right level. We want to discourage guessing, because that's not really a very professional message to give, is it? That if in doubt, well, 50-50. We want to be able to qualify people who show a significantly higher level of understanding than that. And as I said, we're trying to be valid, reliable and fair, and that the assessment style that we choose will inevitably drive the learning behaviour of our learners because they cannot escape it and because it's important. So I was thinking, and Eric and I had some correspondence, we were thinking about guessing and what its implications are. And I do think we have some very clear ideas on this. We know that candidates will try to guess. What we can do is ensure that the odds of them getting that guess correct are reasonable in our terms, and that really we have to do a lot better than offering 50-50, because true-false is 50-50, isn't it? So if we look at our assessments in that light, we need to make sure that we're discouraging guessing. So what does this mean? It means, as I said, true or false questions are not recommended at all. If we look at single best answer, which is what I said is currently very widely used, what we have there is a 1 in 5 chance of getting the answer correct, because the current recommended practice is that there are 5 possible answers, of which only one is correct. And therefore, that is a 20% chance. And I think that's the level of error which applies in the social sciences in general, so in human behaviour. And so while it's not marvellous, it is an acceptable level, I think, to aim for. But that does mean we're immediately in a little bit of hot water if we try and have multiple choice questions, because when we increase the number of correct answers, we also have to increase the number of incorrect answers in order to make sure we avoid the scenario, which I've genuinely have, which I get questions where somebody says, which are the incorrect statements out of the following five? And they give four marks for this, and they have four answers and only one that's being excluded. And I know that that person is up late at night desperate to come up with 20 marks, and they know they've gone past the deadline by 2 months, and they didn't ask their convener or me for help in time. But that means I'm in a really difficult position because Steve has to put it online the next day, and so I have to rewrite that question. And the only way I can fairly rewrite that is to only give one point for a correct answer. And so then I have to borrow questions from elsewhere to make sure there are enough. So if we have 2 out of 5, that's 40% chance of getting it right. So getting a bit close. Okay. So not really recommended. 4 out of 5, definitely not. So this will come up in the practice paper that I want you to look at. So I want you to think about how that works. And what I, as a purist, would recommend, which is not the same as what I have to accept the day before it has to go online, but what I really strongly recommend is that you plan and produce lots of single best answer questions. So 1 out of 5. And I'll show you some examples of what these look like shortly. Yes, 2 out of 7. Yes, that still keeps the guessing odds good. Sorry? Yes, 7 or more. Ha, we're getting into cognitive load, which I will come back to shortly as well. Yeah.
It's good.
Well, up to a point, until we've cognitively overloaded people with the question before they even get to thinking about the answer. So as soon as you start to be generating lots more, I think, aha, time for an EMQ, which generates more more points with less work from you, and therefore they are a good thing. Does that make sense? And I will show you some examples of what those look like. You will have a chance to practice looking at some attempts, and you will have a chance to look at your own.
What is the extent of this match question?
Yes, I have 5 or 6 slides to show you examples of exactly what they look like. And essentially, it's extended matching question, extended matching. You have, say, three clinical conditions and 5 possible or 8 possible diagnostic tests, and you have to match them. Does that make... Yeah, thanks. Yes, jargon alert, MCQs, EMQs. Exactly my question. Thank you very much. Yeah. So as soon as you find yourself thinking, I've got to devise lots of incorrect answers, that's possibly time to try a slightly different approach, because writing good incorrect answers is really hard work, and so it's best to try and not do that all the time. And now we will look at some really detailed examples to make sure that you can see what I'm talking about. So, another area where I find myself having to rewrite a lot of questions is to do with how complicated a question is. So this is what I would term cognitive load. Now, most of our candidates are probably being assessed in English, and that's not their first language. Is that fair enough? Therefore, they already have a higher cognitive load. They translate and they have to work with their knowledge in another language. And what we want to avoid is candidates spending all their mental effort on trying to understand our question and having very little left over for being able to give us a good answer. And I'll give you some examples. You'll have lots of examples of that in the practice set of questions. Essentially, things where you are asking for double negatives or even negatives raises the cognitive load immediately. So, for example, and also where you have lots of options. So if I ask a question like, which three of the following eight options are not correct, that's already requiring the candidate for every time they look at an option to think not correct. That means we're not the correct answer. It's looking for the opposite of that. So is the correct answer incorrect in this context, or is the correct answer correct in this context? And you've already used up the cognitive load before getting to the knowledge, which is what we're supposed to be getting at. And so there are a number of ways to avoid that, one of which is to avoid double negatives if you can. Another way to avoid that is to try and make your questions as short and sweet and clear as possible through trying them out on your fellow experts and other people, and at the very least, reading them out loud to yourself to see if you run out of breath before the end of the sentence. I know it's humble, but it's very good feedback, because what it suggests is if you can't say it all in one sentence, maybe you're trying to say too much. Which brings me to this, talking about giving a little picture of a clinical situation, and they are something we are wanting to encourage. However, there can be linguistically demanding if a clinical description is quite long with quite a lot of information in it. You've already used up quite a lot of cognitive load of your candidate. And so what I would suggest is you make sure that you only include information which is relevant, and that you also, perhaps, cluster questions together. So you have one clinical case and several questions upon it. And therefore, the candidate can reuse some of that mental effort for a number of different questions. And again, we will be looking at ways to generate a number of questions around one particular cognitive area tomorrow, because that is, I think, very helpful, because it stops you having to start from scratch and then find a whole new area to ask questions about. It gives you many ways to actually test knowledge in the one area. More general approaches before we close in on the specific. One way we make assessment fair is to build up a large bank of questions and then randomly select questions from that bank. Now, in the UK, we may do this unofficially in separate institutions of medical schools. In the US, it is done nationally. There is a national question bank for the associate board qualification, which everybody has to do that same exam, and there is talk of doing that in the UK at the moment. For EULAR, what it means is that we need to build up a bank of questions that we know work well. So any question which gives information psychometrically that show it might be a problem needs to possibly be looked at and not be kept for future in a question bank. We have a psychometrician here, so he'll correct me if I make wild generalizations. But in general, we're trying to randomize from a sufficiently large pool of well-tried and tested questions. But of course, it takes time to get tried and tested, and we want to make sure we are developing things, we're keeping up to date with current practice. All of these processes require time, investment, and money to raise them up. So every single assessment process is subject to feasibility, which is, can we afford it? Have we got the time available? you know, do we do the things that are worth doing? So we cannot be perfect, but we do the best we can within what is feasible. So randomising is one good way to do that. Case-based approaches, as we were just discussing, collections of individual questions are based around a single situation or set of problems, is another helpful approach. Another thing which people are criticised for in their assessment is the extent to which their questions represent all potential areas of knowledge. I know this myself. In the last year, I was required to design online questions for really difficult areas, such as the use of medical of the arts and humanities in medicine. So I teach about, you know, poetry, the nature of the human condition, and then I have to design an MCQ question to test that. Believe me, that was quite testing. I did it, because you can do it. But what I did was challenged to think of how to do that for a tricky area. But because I was making sure that the questions represented the syllabus, I knew I had to do that. What we tend to do if we are under pressure is to just generate questions that are easy to generate questions about. And those are often not, they're often at recall level and only in certain areas of the syllabus. So we have to sample correctly in order to avoid sampling error, if you like. And we also have to make sure that we are asking people at the right cognitive level. We also need to make sure we're thinking about the whole clinical cycle. So do we tend to just keep asking about differential diagnoses but forget about some future response to treatment part of a clinical cycle? There's quite a lot to go at there, isn't there? So, you know, think about making sure that you're sampling from all stages of the clinical process as well. Now, hands up, anybody who is on speaking terms with Bloom's taxonomy of the cognitive domain. Give them a prize. I'm going to show a picture which I find so useful in thinking about the nature of the universe. It's a simple idea from the 1950s, updated in the early 2000s, to try and show the nature of knowledge. Okay, epistemology. So what Benjamin Bloom proposed was that there were a whole number of steps of complexity about learning, and that if we, and the higher up we go, the more it's assumed that we've mastered all of the previous steps in that hierarchy. And he said that, well, he didn't say, because he'd gone by then, but Kraftwerl and people who were updating it said, actually the very top level is the level of creation, creating new knowledge. So this is when you are, this is your research, this is the cutting edge of knowledge, where there are no, well, there are rules, but it is not known yet. And so you are operating at a level of very high expertise, which is what I was suggesting, that when you are working on producing the next EULAR materials, you're right at the top of this taxonomy in how you're working. You're working, you know, trying to do complicated juggling on the deck of a ship with a blindfold on, in essence. So it's very demanding. Back at the bottom here, we simply ask people to remember, recall, or recognise some knowledge. We try and check that people understand something we've taught them. But do you see how much of our exams tend to be at this part, this low-level knowledge? Because it's much easier to get people to recall, recognise, or give a summarise, or give a definition of. But that actually those are at the lower level. And there's a big dividing line here. And the reason why we're harping on about clinical context is that applying it in the clinical context is what makes the difference with getting people to operate at the appropriate cognitive level for a postgraduate world. So we are wanting to have people to show how they would put that into practice, how would they implement it, and then we want them to organise and tell the difference between and analyse whether something is working or not, and then we want them to evaluate, tell the difference between things, and then we want them to come up with, you know, treatment plans. And then actually, we may want to give them further information that says actually what you did then didn't work. So go around again. And this is the clinical problem-solving cycle, isn't it, where you're working. And so it's important that we're actually getting people to produce their new plans for treatment and making sure that we're focusing our questions, directing our questions, so they're at the top end of this cognitive hierarchy. Any questions or comments?
What do they expect me to work with to answer this question? I'm not supposed to plan, produce, and create, which is what I want to do on a daily basis, but rather, you know, they ask me, do you increase the dose of allopurinol to 900, or do you give this guy Krystexxa? It's a guy who's working very hard. So yeah, I want to give him Krystexxa to get him functional, but that's not something the insurance would pay, and what's something that the ACR, EULAR, blah, 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 want is to give him the cheaper drug, higher level, which I know is not going to work. And in clinical practice, I do something different. So all of that stuff goes through my head. I not only have to adapt to the 2001 taxonomy rules, but also to what do they expect me to answer to this question. So I guess the one of the things that we probably will learn is how to come to a common denominator. So the Indian rheumatologist and the one from, you know, California kind of apply the same rules as far as what's available, what's the insurances, you know, plan, and all the other stuff. Do we take that into account, or do we learn the common denominator where medicine is practiced this day?
Can I invite a clinical colleague to comment?
It's probably no comment, sorry. Just listening to myself talk.
This is part of the demanding world of practicing in the clinical context, which is, just as I said, half as a joke, that the answer to most questions in education, the answer is it depends, then the answer to much in medicine also is it depends. However, what you're requiring learners to understand is upon what does it depend, and in what proportion of circumstances, according to the current literature, is this the best course of action? And we'll come shortly to looking at things such as a ranking question, where it's very difficult to be so certain of what you're actually recommending that it's very difficult to ask reliable and valid fair questions on that type of domain. So I'd ask invite a colleague to amplify.
So I would almost feel like the common denominator stops somewhere right above understanding. So when it comes to application, like, oh, what test would you do? Would you do a, you know, high-power Doppler ultrasound, whatever? It's all, you know.
And yet you must have a clear picture of what you would expect from a new trainee as opposed to somebody who was a consultant or had been doing this for 10, 20 years and had been invited to write the textbook on it and had done research on it. There must be a good enough level that you have become, that you have constructed an understanding of, which maybe when you were that level you didn't realise, but that when you are more experienced, you look back and you know that that is the level you would expect of a trainee, which would be that essentially they can make sound decisions given the more common situations and conditions, given a responsive patient, given sufficient time and access to advice, and with good supervision, and that people build up from there. But and this is how expertise is built. But Jose, what would you?
I'm not so sure that I understood your questions. I'll have to ask you to speak a little bit slower. because I couldn't follow exactly what you said. But if I understand correctly, meaning at the level that we put the questions on what we are expecting from, students, I think that a good example that we have is the different courses of EULAR. Let's say you might have a question about scleroderma in the general course, and the level of understanding and knowledge that you'd require there would certainly be lower than a question in the scleroderma course. Someone is trying to become a subspecialist in something. Then you may ask this person to be able to perform the Rodnum skin score. But you don't ask that from a general rheumatologist who sees one scleroderma patient, you know, every 2 or 3 weeks or every 2 or 3 months. You are now dealing in the ultrasound course. Someone decided that they want to learn ultrasonography. Of course, the questions were not the same as for me. I know when I should ask for an ultrasound exam, and that's good enough for me as a general rheumatologist. A different thing altogether is I know how to perform it or how to interpret it. So let's say, depending on the level, then you decide at, you know, what kind of level of this taxonomy you are looking at, and therefore design the questions for that. I'm not sure if this addresses your issue. One point, however, that I'd like to use as an opportunity, if Catherine allows me to, is that, let's say, at the level that we are talking, let's say the lowest level of demanding in the EULAR courses, this should not apply, really. You're asking people to practice medicine, to practice rheumatology. The minimum they can do is understand. So actually, I would say that one of the objectives of teaching, in my view, would never be to know. I have I usually make a statement that tends to be rather provocative, that I'd make it now to stir up discussion, in saying that knowledge is useless until it's applied to the benefits of someone. Otherwise, why should I know? Things that you know have no use, I have no use for it. Why should I put that and demand that from my students? One of the issues that we get frequently, and Katerina was telling me, for instance, that she has had this reply, is, well, I cannot think of a clinical context to apply this question. The answer to that should be, should you then ask it? Should you then teach that? Right? If you have no clinical application and you're teaching and assessing clinicians. So also, I don't know if Catherine, you're going to talk about that, but I feel that has one of the most useful pieces of learning in medical education that I got, is that these verbs are actually the kind of verbs that one should use to define our learning objectives. The learning objective is never to know. The minimum is that to explain something, but not to know something. You can't assess that someone knows something. You can, at the best, assess if they can explain it, right? Or apply it, or summarize it, or classify it. So actually, the verbs on top of that letter are words that are most appropriate to define our learning objectives, and they will help you to get the questions as well. I'm not sure if I addressed your issue.
Thank you. So, thank you, Jose. So we've opened up quite big questions here: the nature of knowledge, the nature of clinical context, how to be equitable and fair. These are very demanding areas about which people are still having discussions and disagreements. But these are absolutely the context in which we assess. However, the next bit is a little bit more straightforward. I can show you some specific examples of some actual questions which are used to test this knowledge so that you can perhaps feel more familiar with the tools of this trade so that you can think about how to work with them in future. So if you permit me, I can show you some question formats. And essentially, I'm just going to show you some examples of these. One best answer, what is N recommended to be in this case? Fred, a man of few words just goes like that. Yeah, 1 out of 5, so 20%. What about multiple response? Yeah, well, we're going 2 out of 7 and then probably think of an extended matching question instead, I think. So think carefully about whether that's the way to go. Yes.
The old guidelines
say, yes. I know, and I don't think that formula actually... I know, and what we realised is that guideline is actually a bit confusing and a bit misleading, which is why I chose in this presentation to talk about why we're doing it. We're trying to avoid guessing and try to make sure that we are... So I think we were trying to be clearer by coming up with a formula that is applied in every case, and actually it made it more complicated. So we will, thank you, Jose, make sure that we correct that in the, if that's okay with people. Extended matching questions are strongly recommended, and we'll look at some examples of that. Ranking, there's some challenges, very much because of what you were just telling us about, the challenges of the nature of advice not being so clear-cut, and therefore ranking things in order. If you've got 10 experts in a room, they'd probably all give a different correct answer. And so asking people to rank things is actually begging for problems, difficulties there, but we'll have a look. Images, hotspots, so just to try and vary things a little. So shall we look at some questions? Well, we'll call it anatomy, because maybe you'll feel at home then. But essentially, we have to pick a theme, okay, some, perhaps a part of the process or perhaps a topic, and then we have to give people a stem, a beginning with a clinical context. And you see here there's quite a lot of reading. And then we have to very clearly ask a nice, clear, simple question. So which of the following is the most likely diagnosis? And I would actually recommend that you do habitually put in brackets after that, one mark, because it's being clear. And when we're being clear, it's not the same as making things easier or encouraging people or cheating. It's just being clear. It's hard enough when people are a bit stressed in an exam room. I think it's better to be clear.
So one mark means one good answer.
One point.
Correct answer. Correct,
yes.
Answer.
Shall I, is it, if I say point, like it's a sort of
one
quiz?
Point, but
yes.
Just to comment about what's your suggestion writing into brackets one mark in that situation?
Yes.
It's done each time for the student, actually. We add that even you haven't written that on your questions, at the final examination, we add. If there is only one mark, one correct answer, we are writing one mark. If there are, which of the following, or which two of the following are the most likely diagnosis, we add 2 marks. So the students know how many marks there are for each question. You have to know that. And when you will prepare new questions, you have to.
And if it's not there, I edit it and put it in so that it is absolutely clear, or Steve does, or...
I was completely against that, but you was.
Oh dear, did I? Why were you against it, though, Eric?
Why? Because this increased the difficulty. Not to say how many marks.
Nobody understands. To trap people.
Sure.
To get the proper level.
So now I
agree. It's more clear to say, because people are, I think, non-British mother tongue speakers are confused with these terms.
Yeah.
Why not write one correct answer,
yeah,
two correct
written,
answers?
Written.
Because mark,
yeah.
Mark
so
can be not
sorry, correct. Sorry, we are writing one correct. Or two
correct.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah,
that's good.
Yeah, we are.
That's
good.
Yeah.
There was a
question. Yes,
sir. Why
yeah.
Don't you just write it?
Now, if I may intervene, that's a real deal. So, going past the issue of correct answers versus marks, and discussing the issue of the need to tell the student how many marks or correct answers there are,
because many colleagues still resent that and say, I think it's stupid. If you tell the student how many marks there are, you're making it easier on them. Now, if you don't, what you are making is transforming every single question in yes or no questions. If you don't know how many correct answers there are here, then for each one you think, is this correct or not? Is this correct or not? Is this correct or not? So you are transforming that in yes or no with 50-50 probabilities. So only by knowing how many are correct are you really making sure that the student had the right balance of guessing risk or probabilities that you had in mind. Is that agreeable?
No, I don't think so. This is a clinical case.
That's
you ask a very clear question.
Yeah.
So what's the most likely diagnosis? So in this case, I don't disagree with you, sorry.
No, it's okay, because the text says the most likely, so you're talking about one. What I mean is that, say, the most likely has implicit one mark.
Yeah.
Okay, but just say that in order for you not to put how many marks and not give away, you'd say what is or are the most likely diagnoses with an A, with an E, right? Instead of an I. Because if you don't want to put it clear, you don't want to give it away by saying the most likely.
If you make it like which is or which are,
yeah.
diagnosis,
yes.
Well, then I don't think it's a very clear and good question.
Indeed.
Which diagnoses are compatible with this history or with these findings?
You might say which two of the following diagnoses are compatible. If you get five,
it's not
which
most
two
likely,
or which three that you're telling them, there are multiple of them, I want two or three, I don't want them all, they're not. So let's say you're selecting two out of seven or three out of nine, for instance, but not each one you're telling me yes or no, yes or no, yes or no, because this is not appropriate.
I just want to answer one aspect of that in addition, which is my experience with people who have been clinically trained using this type of assessment. They become very skilled in being able to tell the difference between a possible and the most likely. So it's called single best answer. And so they're each time evaluating which is the best answer in the light of all of the information they've been had, which is actually a more sophisticated test than which is the one correct answer in all cases in the history of the world. However, we do have to have a statistically susceptible process where we have agreed that in this context, when we taught this content and we assessed it in this way on this day, this one was given the status as the correct, most likely answer. So do you see how that's actually a bit of a way of coping with a more complicated universe? Which is what you have to do, isn't it? Yes.
That people would like to make the questions a bit difficult because they think it's too easy otherwise with the multiple choice. And then the test ends up more in a language test,
yes,
than in a test about the topics. And I think that's the risk we have to be aware of it, that it's not a language test, especially when it's for not mother tongue English.
Thank
speakers.
You. Very good point. Fred, do you want the microphone to answer?
Just a comment regarding these questions, this example.
It's not necessarily the best question in the world.
No, of course, but just for overall comment. Is the length of the stem too long?
Personally, I think the length of that stem is quite long, and therefore it is quite a cognitive load. And so I would hope that you could generate several multiple choice questions on the basis of it, or reduce the amount of information given. But I'm not a clinician, so I don't know.
But in the real life, we are with this case. So the overload,
which is back to our earlier discussion about what
is the
being.
Is a reality.
Yeah.
Another issue on the, if I may ask,
another issue on the overload.
So could many issues, yeah.
Could you sometimes, is it plausible to say that you may reduce that problem by allowing more time if you have questions like this or not? How do you feel? Is it the same asking you, let's say, one question per minute or giving you 1.2 on average, for instance?
I think that as a course team or as as assessors, you best practice would be to match your assessment to the needs of the material and the learners. If you find that you wish to assess complex clinical settings, then you may need to have more complicated questions, and therefore you may need to allow slightly more time, particularly as people are doing working other than their first language. So, for example, in the UK, if somebody declares a challenge such as dyslexia, then they are automatically entitled to more time to process written material, because that is deemed to be separate from their cleverness or their knowledge. It's just an aspect of cognitive load. I would argue that people working in a language other than their first language are also operating with an extra cognitive load. So as you were saying, it is not a language test per se, but it would, so there is only straightforward recall tests can, I think some timings perhaps emerged when people used recall tests, and so they had none of this, just these questions, which of the following? And they would say, right, there are 20 of those, and so people can answer them in 30 seconds each. And they calculated the length of exam on the basis of that. But we are now trying to be more sophisticated and to try and quality assure at higher levels as we get more experienced and skilled. But we're not fabulously skilled and experienced yet in EULAR, but we are developing in that direction. Any other questions at this stage about? Oh, they're looking forward to actually trying these out themselves, I can tell.
As students, I mean, not as examiners. Yeah.
That's right. So here's another example of a single best answer out of six. Okay. So slightly worse odds than one out of five. Some text, but actually there's a picture. Is the balance right between those?
Just worth a
words. Yes?
Just need a picture to get the right answer.
Of course, when you're very, very experienced, yes.
Yeah.
Because you're an expert. So this is just an example of an illustrated question which uses single best answer approach.
Yes. But again, the essay, we may be careful to the point of avoiding what is your diagnosis. I remember a colleague of mine used to be a kind of a joker that said,
yeah,
my answers are correct. And the teacher said, how come? All of them were wrong. No, you asked my opinion. I'm absolutely correct. So it's the most likely diagnosis would be more open, right? Than to what is your diagnosis or my diagnosis, right?
Oh, there's some discussions ahead for improving things.
May I? If I use this case to also make a comment about the clinical context, would you, or who amongst you, would consider this to be a case-based question? Is this a case-based question? Not really. You give the context, and then you ask a theoretical question. You don't ask people to apply it, right?
The story is unnecessary.
Unnecessary. You could just ask that without the story, right? And this is the kind of thing that quite frequently, and I insist on having case-based questions, I get back. Now, and If I may use that opportunity to show you in my mind frame how easy it would be to change this into a case-based question, you just have to ask, let's say as a second question, if you admit that this patient, what would be the most likely cause for this condition, or three of the most likely causes, instead of asking what are the causes of hypothyroidism? Now you expect the person to realize that this may be hypothyroidism and realize potential causes for that. But you don't have to change much, it's just a different frame of mind, right? That
This shows you're getting in the right frame of mind for the activity I have. One of the tests, if you cover the clinical vignette and you can still answer the question, it is not a clinical context question. That's exactly what you showed for us.
This is for the board of the British Medical School.
This is a medical school where they have a very limited clinical context.
I challenge the answers. I challenge the answer. In this 24-year-old woman, what about Graves' disease? Well, maybe this is not for this forum, but maybe you could take this
in
question
back to the
board.
In case the UK is incorrectly treating. Thank you so much.
You're not sure you got the right answer there.
Yeah, it's an example, it may even just be a random ticking of boxes just to reassure the UK. Thank you. You see how much discussion and potential there is for improving questions that are being used? So, here is an example of the famous, or much mentioned, extended matching type of question. So again, this may be suffering from the undergraduate syndrome, and you would be able to enhance this, but the basic idea is you have some clinical situations and you have some possible answers. And the challenge is to match the right answer with the situation. So do you see how that's a very flexible way of testing quite a lot of knowledge in one question? And I'm sure this can be enhanced and improved, but I'm showing it you just as a basic example. So I'm going to try and show you some others rather than dwell on each. So here again, this is one where you just can have, in this case, a drop-down menu.
Catherine, the options are the same for all the different clinical scenarios, am I right?
They can be, but you can vary it by having different options for different questions if you wish.
Okay.
But one common method might be three cases, six options. Might be treatment, might be causes, might be, as the last one was, particular biological, anything that can match with anything else, basically.
Would we be allowed to have, say, the same answer for two different clinical scenarios? Is that okay?
Very good point. We were just talking about when it's how much information to share with a candidate. And one of the things that it's important to share with the candidate is the implications of their choices. And so it is good practice to say at the top, each answer may occur once, unlimited times, or not at all. So, just to spell out what the permutations are. I'm not sure that actually helps much because it actually says anything is allowed, but to think about what guidance you do give.
We are starting from one correct answer on MCQ to a nightmare.
You must use extended matching questions wisely.
Is that a nightmare for the student or for the... for the question producer?
Believe me, I have had questions where there were 8 possible clinical cases and 15 possible answers on to drop down from. Think of the cognitive load. Please do not do that. So you have to think of it the right way round, which is going to be your drop down choice and which is going to be your situation. You can swap them. Whichever makes the best use of the cognitive load to assess the knowledge.
Okay.
Makes sense? I think the best way to deal with this is to give you some examples to improve. And also to challenge you to write one. You could do it with images. So less writing, so better for language tests, so a good variation to have. You can do it with hot spots on pictures. So again, less writing, automatic clinical context. Now, ranking. This is a bit tricky because, as I said, what are the rules for giving points? Does somebody have to get all three absolutely correct and guess what you as an expert decided was the answer? If so, that's actually quite difficult for many areas of knowledge. And so, or do you accept three answers that were on your list but were in any order? Or do you give that 0 points? So do you see, it raises quite a number of questions that you have to make sure you have given correct and full information about how you want that to be set. And for that reason, ranking questions don't get used that much because I think it's actually quite difficult to come up with ones that are successful. You could label something. That's quite low level, isn't it? But it might be something you could use.
You can actually mark on the picture the area that is acceptable as a correct answer. You see what I mean?
Okay. Yeah.
So let's say you pinpoint that and say yes if the cursor is put on this area, this is correct.
This is what I mentioned earlier about a way to perhaps manage language and cognitive load, that you could have a choice of questions. But it's, again, it is still linguistically challenging. And there's always quite a lot of debate about what is the correct answer. So I just use it to illustrate, and that's very recall.
It's more appropriate for recall, isn't it?
Yes, unless you're very clever. So, what do you usually use, and which of those are new to you and you think have some potential for your area? A couple of minutes to discuss, please. What we need to aim for is to produce plausible distractors, is the term. So plausible means quite a lot of it is probably true, and some people believe it. However, we're looking for the single best answer. And so the thing that is plausible is to distract the learner from the best answer.
One problem.
Just one?
Just one.
That's good.
I don't promise it's my last one, but it's the only one now. One difficulty that I find when I'm building questions is that I find it much, much easier to find distractors for wrong answers than for correct options in terms of diagnosis, for instance. I think that this is typically, let's say, ill-advised according to medical education. Say that, for instance, I have a clinical scenario and I want the most probable diagnosis, but I find it easier, and I believe that many clinicians do, to ask the most unlikely diagnosis.
Oh, right. So the most false.
Well, the most.
Or the least best.
The least best.
Oh, we're moving into negative. Ask checking for a negative there.
Yeah, but if I write the most unlikely, am I double negativing it? The most unlikely. You don't like it.
What do other people? I was trained as a programmer where you never test for the negative. You always test for the positive because logically, it is the best way of testing, and therefore it's automatically raising the cognitive load a little. But of course the answer is it depends. Yes, okay.
So I wasn't sure, do you really suggest not to use questions like which of the 5 answers is not correct? So you give 4 correct answers and 1 incorrect answer.
I would say
I mean,
that
these
in
are
that
very
circle,
common, but
they are. In
but
that
you
case,
think it's not so good to have these sort. This sort.
In every one of those cases, I always highlight the word "not," because in distress, a candidate is more likely to misinterpret that. So I'm just advising that obviously that has raised the cognitive load in the question, not in the answer. We had recent feedback from a student who said, please reduce the heterogeneity of your types of questions. She said, I was asked which 3 of 6 is incorrect, which 4 of 7 is correct, which 5 of 8 is... And so there's also the sequence of cognitive load. So you have to think about the balance as well as the individual question. So I would just say that that is increasing.
I mean, this is, of course, then you can ask, if you have 3 of 6, you can ask for the correct ones. But I mean, if you just have 4 correct ones and 1... It's always easier to have 1 mark, and I think we like this particularly.
Anyone care to
But if
comment.
You think it's... I mean, shall we still use this type of question or not? So
I'm saying it is possible, but you bear in mind that it has a cognitive load. It has to be clearly marked,
yeah, sure.
And a certain proportion of candidates will always not read it.
Okay.
You could say that's part of the test, but it's a possible quality factor. In summary, it is not best practice.
Okay.
Just to mention about the extended matching question, you have to have these 4 elements. You have to have a theme on which you are asking. You have to have some options. You have to have the lead-in statement. And then you have to have at least 2 different situations. I'll show you what I mean. Oh, and I did alter the spelling. I thought I'd give you a vet situation. So I thought a 10-year-old dog and a shorthorn cow would cheer us up at this stage. But you have to have all of these elements before you can construct your question. But you can get 3 marks out of only a small number of options. So think about how these things relate.
Is the choice of a shorthorn cow, was it intended to reduce the emotion? If it was a longhorn cow, the emotion might be...
Well, I'd have to ask a vet. Presumably, there are different treatments for a shorthorn cow than there are for a giraffe. And so they do everything a clinician does on all the different species. So here is just a long list of things that can be generated for extended matching questions. Some of these are obviously at a recall level for undergraduates, but there are an awful lot of potential directions you can go in. You can even check basic science, but obviously this is at the lower level, but may be thought appropriate for your area of clinical expertise. You can also slightly vary the format so that people can select more than one item. Or you could limit the choices. But whatever you do, pay attention to the overall cognitive load, so which comprises the amount of reading somebody has to do, the amount of choices they have to make, and the direction of the number of items they're matching with the other pair. So identify a theme, write a lead-in, prepare a list of options, write those items and review them and check them. And at the very least, if a colleague has difficulty determining the correct answer, then you will need to modify it. And this raises an important point, which is that assessment is too important to do alone. It's like producing a book. You have to have other people to help raise something to the level that it needs to be at. So, you know, whether some person is in a proofreading mode to check something, or whether you are exchanging possible questions to compare that your expert colleague can understand what you intend, because we are all trying to avoid ambiguity and to produce the best product we can. So I'm keen to invite you to look at some questions and suggest some possible enhancements. So I will leave EMQs for the moment. I will just draw your attention to the acknowledged world leader in assessment setting, Case and Swanson, who make their Bible, and it's hundreds of pages long with examples, but it's available free to everybody. You've probably started to discuss what you normally use and what you avoid, so I will move us forward, because I want to talk about the checklist now. These are what I spend my whole time doing. Obviously, I spell check everything and change things to the UK spelling. Sorry, it's the only thing we have left to offer the world, correcting American spelling. So I try and make sure that as an English first language speaker, this is with multiple qualifications and degrees in writing and literature, I can help with this. So I try to add this extra level of proofreading. So for example, I am trapping very many obvious mistakes that people make when they are under pressure. And so quite often it will be simple things, but simple things that I cannot put right. So I cannot tell you what the correct clinical answer was if you have accidentally forgotten to put that in. And if there's any ambiguity, and so something says correct, this is an interesting case because in 20% of animals, the short-horned cow is the main person to suffer from this. I don't know if you're telling me if it's correct or incorrect. So you have to use a consistent way of telling a non-clinician exactly how to interpret things. And then after me, it goes to Steve, who's a very fluent French speaker and speaks IT. And so he has to then turn it into the actual online test. So, you know, the clearer you can be, the better. Really often, and I will rewrite anything to make it as clear as possible. But again, I can't do that if I don't understand what you're trying to say or if I don't know the clinical answer. Quite often, people, it adds up to less than 20 points, and so I don't have enough points to offer or enough questions, so we have to borrow from another exam because we haven't sufficient time to go back to you. Really often, people have run out of energy and could only think of two possible or three possible distractors, and so that is inviting guessing, so that is a problem. Or they ran out of energy and could only think of a couple of words or something that was obviously not a good quality distractor, so it hasn't functioned correctly. Or they desperately try and come up with points by asking for four correct out of five, that sort of thing.
Should we as conveners of the course make it unacceptable to have more than three correct answers in a single question, except for extended matching?
Yes, very definitely. Yeah. Well, we should be aiming for one in five.
We should put that.
One thing I can put right is I can write how many points or how many correct answers are attached to each question so that it's clearly spelt out. So I can make all of those changes if necessary, but I'd rather you did, because then you could share it with each other and you would know exactly what you meant. So pulling all these ideas together, I put them together into a checklist, which you have in your pack. So could you now look in your folder and have a look at the checklist. This is the first trial of the EULAR checklist. We are hoping that we will learn some things by using it and make it better. How I constructed it was I put together all of my advice and thought into a series of philosophical recommendations in this first section, and we have discussed all of them. So this is what I do every time. I spell check the whole paper. I add up the points, the correct answers. I cannot check how it relates to taught material, but I can tell if something appears several times and appears to be the same topic, but I won't take any action. But it's something that I would like you and conveners to be looking for. Quite often, people have edited and improved something, and then maybe they've ended up with the points and the correct number of answers not matching some other aspect of the question, if you see what I mean. So somebody may have improved a question and said, oh, you can't have 3 out of 5, but then I end up with answers that are 3 questions which it says are correct. So if I have any ambiguity, I have to remove the entire question. Is it clear? Well, if I can understand it, I can usually improve the question, but sometimes I just cannot understand what people are trying to say, and so therefore that is going to be too difficult for somebody who is not an experienced assessor who has written books on the subject and is a native English speaker. So it's likely to be too difficult. We've talked about avoiding simple recall. We've talked about setting things in a clinical context and how if you remove the context and you can still answer the question, that you've actually cheated. It's not really in a clinical context. You've just told a clinical story. And we've talked about having a range of things. So those are all of the questions to bear in mind before we start. And then you need to look at each specific question in the light of those aspects. And then I've tried to summarise in a more prescriptive way what you must have for a single best answer question. So I am strongly recommending that you have at least 4 plausible but incorrect options for every 1 correct answer. So remember that 20% rule. And to be plausible, each of those distractors should be approximately the same length, be grammatically constructed in a similar way, and avoid saying things that are easy to guess, like never, always. Oh yeah, we haven't mentioned this. Where anybody says all of the above, none of the above, that's a cognitive load red flag, because it usually means that there's more brain power on the question than there is on the answer. So I would advise you to avoid those. So what I recommend is that you convert it, if it's a very complicated question, into an extended matching or rewrite. Have you thought of ranking questions? But if it's really not appropriate, don't. Have you thought of visual stimulus questions? So what I wanted to do in this checklist was just bring all those aspects to mind and try and give you a more systematic way to review questions. And as I mentioned, you know, in operating theatres, a checklist can dramatically improve safety. So we're going for dramatic improvement. Well, we're going for conscious awareness of where things are challenging. So time to apply your understanding now, because in your pack is also a set of questions which I would like you to consider in the light of the checklist. Remember, not the one with the comments on. Put that out of your mind. It wouldn't necessarily help anyway. I would like you to spend some time now, probably 10 or 15 minutes on your own, or working with someone else, up to you, looking through these, making a few notes to identify how you would rewrite or change some of these questions so that they were better in the light of what we've discussed. And what I then have is a suggestion of how I would think of rewriting them to share with you, to make sure if you have any questions that we have answered each of them. It is now 6 o'clock, so we have got up to 30 minutes for this whole session to look at these, try and improve them, and make sure we end up understanding why I've suggested those improvements. I've now suggested everything I can think of to improve questions, so it's a question of what we learn from trying it out. So what I wanted to do was to invite you to raise any outstanding issue or question which you would like me to answer in those 10 minutes, because otherwise what I propose is that you take this experience of using the checklist and all our discussions, have a little break, and then you bring those together to use on your real questions in your area, which everybody has been asked to bring with them. So I do, and Jose and myself, we will be moving around, so I can still answer your questions later if that's helpful, even though the answer is usually it depends. But if there are specific things which applying that understanding has brought out, I need to know now. Yes, Eric.
Steve has to know in order to put it on the system. It's a good question, and as you have seen, because assessment is teaching, you have, and it is mandatory to give feedback for each answer. This is mandatory. Why it's true, sometimes you have to give feedback, sometimes not. Why it's false, and you have to give feedback, why it's false, because. And it's a general comment, because it's not clear for everybody. The general structure of each model is one state-of-the-art review, with two clinical cases with feedback with the same rules as we have seen today, the two in-depth discussion, and after that, at the end, is coming the 20 marks or correct answers assessment. To reach the next module, the students should validate this assessment 20 marks. That's what we prepare now.
This is, sorry.
Yeah.
20 marks, does it mean 20 questions with 20 correct answers?
No, 20 marks are 20 correct answers.
20 marks. So there can be one question.
This is 20 points. I use the word marks because it's everywhere written marks. Nevertheless, you have to keep in mind a mark is a correct point. It's a good answer. A multiple choice question with 5 items and 1 correct answer is 1 mark. So, and you, for this final assessment, and if you check in the tool, the final assessment for the module is written A1, assessment 1, with 20 correct answers. And the students will test his knowledge using the first 20 marks correct answers assessment. And thereafter, he will see the answers And for this reason, it's mandatory to have the feedback so the student can increase his knowledge. And we ask to you a second set of 20 marks correct answers. And the file is called A2, Assessment 2, with 20 correct answers. This file is used for the bank for the final examination at the end of the course.
Is that clear? I can see one implication of that, which for an extended matching question, we might have saved time in setting the question, but it's probably not going to be feasible to give full feedback for every single instance, for every single not correct answer.
I have a question. Perhaps it's because I haven't done the course myself. Do students get the feedback as soon as they mark the question, or do they have the feedback at the end of the test?
At the end.
Okay, thank you.
So this is in terms of saving time. So when you do the A2, the second set of questions for the exam, the students don't get feedback on those. So presumably you don't need as much extensive justification of the answers for those. Is that correct?
Good point. It is correct, nevertheless.
Because you are picking.
I'll give a short explanation. I am preparing all the final assessment, and I am not expert in all topics. And if you give a small feedback, I'm sure it's correct or not correct. If you don't give feedback, sometimes I cannot see if there is a mistake. You understand?
Well, we're going to hear you rather than the camera.
Yeah.
Well, may I?
Other questions
and also
here,
quite often we have to borrow from the A2 bank to replace failed questions in the A1 bank. That's really common. If there is insufficient time to come back to you to get you to rewrite questions, so it is still good practice. And remember, the A2 bank, they should be our best questions that are saved for the final exam. They shouldn't be our worst questions.
What about for assessment one, if the student doesn't reach the 20 marks, does he pass the same test again, or the same test, the same questions, or until he knows them by heart? Or?
The assessments at the end of each module are not summative, they are formative assessments. So they are supposed to give you feedback and allow you an extra opportunity for learning. So there's no problem that the students will then look at the feedback, go back and answer them all. He has to get them all right to get to the next, but it's very easy for him to get them all right. So we leave to the student to decide whether he feels that he needs to read the module again or he just cheats on it. Well, the final assessment will be a summative one. So be aware if you don't learn. You know, that's the idea.
I'd also like to make a further point. Also, from my experience as a student of the online courses, I think it's important that the answers to the questions are traceable back to the content of the module. Because even if it's a question that seems very reasonable according to the further global knowledge that the test developers have, for the student, and maybe it's also something to think about when we write the feedback, I think it's really good to be able to get back to the course and check where this info is that he or she missed. So this would be something I'd keep in mind.
You know, I perfectly agree, because Wojcik commented that as a convener of the pediatric course, I have to check, in fact, if in the text it is explained, the question is explained enough, because this is another issue. That the question should be clinically oriented, I completely agree, but should also have the knowledge basis in the text, otherwise.
One of the ways that one could spot that is, again, if you look at the answers by the students. If they failed, you know, on high numbers, you should ask yourself, you know, what is this? So I usually, when I give feedback as a convener to the others, I say, well, answers like that, either the question is badly built or the teaching is not appropriate for the question, so you check that. Right?
We have reached the 6:30. Sorry, you had a question?
Yeah, in fact, I really would know what's wrong about those, because I heard you discussing next to us and you had very good ideas, and it would be great to have a comment on each of the questions we discussed, but there is no time for this, I don't know. But because, I mean, this is what we really practically learn. What's the problem with some of the questions? And I think we didn't get everything, so we need feedback from the others after this work here.
Okay, I'm happy for you to take that, either to raise a question with me based on the comments that I made, or to carry on your discussion with your colleagues who are in the next session with you. But in essence, all of the changes which I would recommend to those questions were ones that we have discussed. So they were to do with making sure each question has a number. Each question says how many points are available.
We need to know specifically what's the problem with these. Because we have working groups now, and we are eager to get the results.
You have the answers in your pack. And there's a second version of the same questions, and I have put my comments at the side of each place where I would recommend a change. Is that helpful? Because I am aware I want you to learn from that experience, and if any of those you would like to discuss, I can certainly do that with you. Just to clarify, there's just been one question raised.
The important thing from what we are learning.
Just a reminder for clarification, and I think it's my mistake of not being clear. On one of the questions, there was a question 10, but as you know, people have not necessarily got the questions numbered correctly, which is also a difficulty.
Page is 10?
Our page 12, there is a comment. Question 10, which of the following is abnormal in the examination of a child less than 2 years of age? One point. What I am commenting here is to say that all of the above is not a recommended use of an answer. As we discussed earlier, all of the above, none of the above, those are both signs of desperation, I feel. But they are not clear enough for what we are trying to achieve, and that is why that is highlighted. What I want to do now is to clarify that we have achieved all of these activities that we set for this session. There are more sessions to come. There is one more session this evening, which is where we now invite you to work with module conveners and other people who are contributing to your course, the same course, to invite you to apply these ideas to your real questions.